actually recording.
Rebel scum.
Scum. Scumbags. Right. Fictionally known as scumbags at one point. Episode of Rebel Scum Radio. I'm your host, Karlos, and I'm joined here by my fellow Rebel Scum, Jim, Bob, and Jono.
G'day.
So, in this podcast, we're going to cover a lot of stuff, but we're going to give you a rundown of what we'll be going through week to week to week. So, we're going to be going through everything Star Wars. I know that's going to be strange, seeing as the name is Rebel Scum Radio.
Yes.
We'll be going through movies, all the latest from TV across the world, movie trailers, games, comics, science and technology, some pro wrestling, some UFC.
Basically everything geek.
Everything geek.
Don't forget manga.
Yeah. We're going to have the latest in music mixes from our resident DJ Stereo. And we're going to delve into the deep, dark world of the paranormal. So, to start the show, we're going to start off with Star Wars.
It's only fitting, isn't it?
Yes, it is. It is fitting. So, Jim, Bob, do you want to take us away?
All right. Well, it was a pretty exciting day today because two things happened. Firstly, during work hours, I happened to see TV spot number 6 featuring Finn in full lightsaber glory action.
All his glory.
Have you noticed that he has an American accent?
Yeah, that's all right. Yeah.
But it's pretty traditional to have a British accent in Star Wars.
Yeah, I know.
It's like he's...
But see, there's a lot of people have moved to Tatooine from London. So,
Because they're all wearing straight out of Tatooine too.
But no, it's good because I saw TV spot 6, which is obviously a part of the Disney machine where they're just churning out more and more new content, spoiling it ever so more every day.
Yeah, well, that's something it. What do you guys think about it? Have they released too much?
No. Well, they still don't know much about the plot.
No, and we probably don't... there's all these theories flying around and I don't really care because no one's going to get it right, obviously.
Yeah.
So that's all speculation. And we're it's obvious that it looks like Han Solo acquires Finn and Rey somehow on his journey somehow. He's probably visiting Tatooine to pay his respects to...
I'm still sticking firm with my theory that they're the illegitimate children of Lando. I'm sticking with that theory.
They released that on Amazon, that the toy, and it said Lando Calrissian's son.
Yeah, but is that's fake. That's got to be fake, surely.
He's not the only black guy in the galaxy, is he?
Is he? I think he is, wasn't he, in all the movies?
I think we got Mace Windu.
They have to. They have to. Yeah, it's true. That's true. But, I mean, there's still got to be something, even though they're getting rid of all the old canon, there's got to be some basis that this new story has on that. So some of these fanboys will be right.
Yeah.
I mean, this Jar Jar Binks Sith theory is a bit...
No, let's forget about it. If they're dumping the old canon, let's just forget about it.
And the circus is really playing Jar Jar Binks and he's turned to the dark side.
That's one
theory.
Yeah. No, I don't think people want that. And I think anyone who's working for Disney would probably go, you know, let's put that on the shelf, that one.
Yeah, but going through the theory as it was presented on Reddit, if you do read it...
Is it about Jar Jar?
It's feasible. It's feasible because in the... his skills and what he does in terms of his movements are only ever seen in the film by Jedi.
What do you mean?
The way he flips into the water.
Yeah.
Like the way he can jump and move.
So you're saying, his style is to Jedi's as drunken Kung Fu is to Kung Fu. Is that what you're saying, Carl?
What I'm saying,
are you hinting at that?
What I'm saying that he has skills that in the films you generally associate users of the Force.
So his Force power is befuddlement and silliness and misdirection, and is it? Misdirection.
Well, he appears to be using the Force for shitness. that's how it appears.
Force shit everywhere.
Force shit everywhere. But it's an interesting theory. And if it happens, if he...
So wait, did it say that he's a Jedi or he's a Sith?
A Sith. A Sith. Because he's walking around with Palpatine in the movies.
Because
he's going into the center.
Andy Serkis' character, he's supposed to be this tall leader.
Yeah.
And there was some concept art that was leaked and he had like a snout.
Yeah. Well, see, I looked at that concept art when I saw that.
Supposed to be snake-like.
And there was... There were some images that were in the Reddit post that had... that were the set makers and the costume makers and they pointed out some of... what we're gunging in the background.
Yeah.
Mm.
I still believe that the image on the right was actually more likely General Grievous's head.
Right.
Rather than a gungan.
Yeah. See, I'm too scared to hop onto these websites and read up on all of this stuff because all these headlines that pop up in multiple feeds, whether it be through Facebook or IGN's suggested articles... Mm. You know, this is a spoiler-free such and such, and I try not to read it all. So I am watching the trailers, and I'm enjoying them, and I'm piecing together that obviously Han Solo somehow by magic, like he did in the first film, he happens to come across Rey and Finn, and obviously the next 30 to 40 years of Disney is working with these people for the rest of their lives.
Very small galaxy. So, you just run into these people just randomly.
Yeah, that's right.
That's it. I mean, the greatest challenge I'm facing with Star Wars right now is the analysis of every trailer where they break it down and try and present it. I cannot not watch it.
No. See, you need to resist.
That's what I check every morning when I get up in the morning. Just check the comic book websites.
Yeah, I know. You've got to resist.
They've broken me.
Look, I'll put it this way. I probably saw the Martian trailer once, you know, and Matt Damon goes to Mars, blah, 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 whatever. Yeah. He doesn't come home. But that was probably the one time I saw it. So I knew the basic synopsis.
Yeah.
But went to Dandenong Cinema, watched it. 2 hours later, again, I really enjoyed that.
Yeah.
There was a lot of stuff because I'd only fleetingly seen the trailer.
Yeah.
Whereas I'm way more invested in the Star Wars trailer, so I know a lot already. Yeah. But you can tell they're careful about
There's still a lot we don't know. They just recycle most of the footage. Yeah.
And it's a two and like you were touching on the runtime of it earlier before you pressed record.
Yeah.
And 2 hours and 15 minutes, that's a hefty slog.
It will be.
We don't know about General Hux much about General Hux.
You could say it was impressive.
About Supreme Leader Snoke.
There's been nothing released about Luke's role in the film?
There was an image leak of him, but then it was taken down.
Yeah.
He was in his beard and shit.
Yeah. So it'll be interesting to see. Like, I'm not going in knowing what's going to happen, but... I still feel like I know more than I should.
I wasn't around in 1977 because I wasn't born until a couple of years later. But if you hunt down the original theatrical trailer for Star Wars, it was pretty rough.
Yeah.
Rough as guts trailer.
Yeah.
That didn't even have the John Williams score used. Yeah. Like it was almost like
Did it come in black and white? Or was it?
No, it was all colour back then, but I'm just saying that...
But the trailers back in the 70s were magnificent.
Yeah, yeah.
The way The way they vocalised all through the trailer.
Yeah, and they got the narrator.
Yes.
Yes.
Luke, yeah, these
take on the Galactic Empire. Yeah. Yes, Luke and Han take on the Galactic Empire in this awesome adventure in space.
Yeah,
space.
So I generally feel like most films give away too much.
These days, easily.
Actually, one of the better trailers that hasn't given away much recently is actually the Suicide Squad one.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because there's only the one real beefy trailer, and that's
really it. Visuals. Yeah. It doesn't give anyway much away.
But we know that Batman is in it, so...
Yeah.
I was a bit annoyed at myself for watching the Batman versus Superman trailer in full.
That's insane.
But when the second one came out, it's like, all right, now you've shown too bloody much.
Yeah. No, but you still don't know who the main villain is.
Yeah, but someone, you see stupid headlines where they're saying, oh, concept artwork may have leaked.
Oh, it's going to be Doomsday.
It may not be. But why would you introduce him this early on when you've... You know, let the Batman versus Superman thing die down first. Don't bring in the one bloody villain that actually ultimately kills Superman.
I reckon they'll save him for the Justice League movie.
Yeah, why not?
They will need the ultimate.
I don't know much about the Superman comics, but obviously after Superman dies, I'm assuming he gets resurrected somehow or comes back.
Spoiler alert.
But true... Users of DC Comics would know the answer to that, so we're preaching to the converted.
Yeah. I mean, like, we should all voice our allegiances to comics, I guess.
Oh, yeah, I suppose I better be upfront about what I like.
I'm very much a DC boy.
Yeah, I'm DC.
I think the Marvel...
I like the Marvel TV shows, but not the movies.
See, I love...
I like Daredevil, and I'm looking forward to Jessica Jones that's coming out on Friday on Netflix.
See, I love the DC TV shows... I'm addicted to Gotham and Arrow.
I'm still on edge with Flash and stuff.
Flash, yeah, but...
Hang on,
we've got a call.
We've got a call. First call on the Rebel Scum Radio.
Hang on. Here we go.
Hello, you're live on Rebel Scum Radio. How you going there? Do you want me to press pause? Yeah, we better press pause.
Is that a small moon? No, it's a space station. Caught in the Death Star. No escape from this tractor beam. Oh, be close your eyes. Be one with the Force and see. Now a Sith, not a knight. Lot of dark, little light. Anyway, the Force flows. Doesn't really matter to me. To me. And Jabba just captured her. Took him down without a fight, and now he's frozen carbonite. Well, Jabba, Luke Skywalker's come to free his friends and take them all away. Jabba, didn't mean to kill Rancor. Two does not see my secret signal. Leia, take that chain and choke him.
Boba Fett, daily report. Too late.
My time has come. Sarlacc is where I die. But he's dissolving all the time. Goodbye, everybody. I'm in a pit. I gotta find my way out before I'm eaten alive. Yeah. Jabba, I don't wanna die.
I see a little silhouette of a green man.
Master Yoda, will you raise up my X-Wing?
Force of the lightning, very, very frightening me.
Obi-Wan!
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 Obi-Wan Kenobi!
Jedi Master!
I'm just a slave boy, Qui-Gon's come to free me.
Here's a chosen one from the prophecy, sparing his life from this captivity.
Easy come, easy go, water let me go.
Anakin, no, I will not let you go.
Let him go.
Anakin,
I will not let you go.
Let him go.
Anakin,
I will not let you go.
Let me go.
Will not let you go.
Let me go.
Never, never, never let me go.
Mamma shmia,
let me go.
Lord Palpatine as an apprentice put aside for me, for me, for me.
Record?
Yes.
All right. So, as I was saying, I was a child of the 80s.
Yes. Yep.
Which meant when I was the age of knowledge, getting into my teens,
yeah.
I was lucky enough to witness the original Batman animated series on morning TV, yeah?
The original? Which one
was
that?
I'm talking about the 90s Batman animated series.
Oh, yeah.
So proper...
Not the Adam West.
I saw those in the 80s.
But still got to see his balls in his.
That's a very revealing pantaloon you're wearing there.
But the
Joker did look pretty awesome in that.
Joker and the Riddler are both good. That show addicted me to the Riddler.
He's a bit David Bowie labyrinth-esque, the Riddler, but in terms of.
Who's your favourite villain?
Clayface. In the animated series.
Out of DC or
out of all? Well,
hang on.
There is just DC villains.
You're jumping away.
Because Marvel villains are all shit. They're all shit. That's the one thing that frustrates me about Spider-Man.
Some fanboy wars on.
So good, so close to being superb, and yet it's fucking Sandman and Green Goblin like. Fucking
no, Carnage and Venom are pretty good.
Venom.
I'm sorry. I'm a Marvel. I'm not saying I'm not Team DC, but I am a bit team Marvel. DC. And when I was a kid, also in the 90s, there was the Spider-Man animated series,
which was
tastefully done and very well done.
Look, that being said, with Marvel, some of my favorite films still of superhero films. Are the 1970s and 80s Hong Kong Spider-Man films?
Yeah, see, I haven't seen.
Kind of like he's running around Hong Kong in a onesie.
I haven't seen those. I've seen a bit on YouTube, but I haven't.
I've seen
watched
all
them
the Spider-Man TV series.
Yeah. Well, that's pretty much what the films are like. Yeah. Yeah,
but look, I'm probably I'm going to have to say 50-50. I both love both Marvel and DC equally, just because obviously Christopher Reeve's Superman, you know, Michael Keaton Batman, Tim Burton's, you know, version, like, they're all things that we grew up with, and they were really bloody well done.
Going back to Superman, I still believe that there's never been a genuinely good Superman film.
I think Man of Steel is pretty good. Not up there. It could have been better.
I don't think they've ever really... Maybe the original Superman 2 from back in the day when Zod first came on the scene.
Superman 2?
Superman 2.
Yeah,
because it was with that Elvira chick spandex.
Yeah.
Elvira in spandex.
Very much too.
With laser eyes. Lasers.
And I get the feeling that because the last Superman... it wasn't that bad a film, but it wasn't great for Superman.
But Henry Cavill, he nails it.
He nails it all,
in the modern version, I think.
But they've had to add Batman
to promote Superman.
Yeah, but can you please tell me why in
that
all these...
Supergirl is one of my favourite shows.
Yeah, but what... Can you tell me why, though...
I haven't seen the first episode. Oh, I've seen the pilot.
So damn hard.
You know, when I see all these... Carl. Yeah. So when I see all these, you know, Justice League, you know, cartoon Netflix movies and that they're posting on Netflix they're great.
Yeah,
but, you know, the people who attack Earth, they're interstellar beings, they're of immense power.
Yeah.
But we've never really seen that in the live action format. Because, you know, they're all humanoid people.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where the aliens? Where them aliens?
You got it in Avengers.
Yeah.
Yeah, but no. We're talking about Superman. We're talking about Superman because everything feels a bit humanoid-y. Whereas where's this?
I guess
the
kind of a DC thing. Like, there's, I mean, when you take out really the Green Lantern, most of their heroes are very down to earth,
humanoid.
They're more human than superheroes.
But you got Brainiac.
Yeah, you got Brainiac. You got the Flash, but when you look at TV shows like Gotham, Arrow, and then Flash.
Yeah, it's all human.
They're all human. And even if you go to Batman, Batman's not really a superhero. He's a superhero, but
he's the greatest detective.
But he's a guy with super skills. And Green Arrow is a guy with super skills.
They're
very grounded and down to earth.
Yeah.
Grounded in reality.
Flash and Superman, they've got super skills, but they still.
So is it Green Lantern's fault that? Like interstellar beings attack Earth and stuff, and
yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, it's his fault, isn't it?
I can't really talk about Green Lantern.
But he's coming. He's coming back in the next Justice League.
Not
Ryan Reynolds.
Played by who?
Don't fucking mention Ryan Reynolds. Me.
Well, hang on. No,
he's
but what
ruined
about
that film?
Yeah,
well,
but
actually,
what
ruined anyone, no matter who?
Yeah, but what about
maybe Jon Stewart? So,
are you saying he's going to ruin Deadpool as well?
No.
He's suited for Deadpool.
He's meant for Deadpool.
But as Hal Jordan, he sucked.
So there might be a new Hal Jordan and a new John. Is it John Stewart?
Yeah.
John Stewart, yeah.
Yeah.
But they've got to keep Henry Cavill in the picture because no one looks like Superman than Henry Cavill.
Yeah. He's signed up for like five films or some shit.
His middle name is Kal-El. Is that it? What's his Superman's real name?
Kal-El.
Say Henry Jor-El Cavill. That's his. unknown middle name.
Okay. Jor-El is the father.
What's the son's name?
Kal-El.
This is how much I don't like Superman.
He's sketchy on the details.
Honestly, I never liked Superman as a kid, ever.
Oh, I love this Christopher Reeves.
I was always
Superman
Batman
1 and 2.
Always a
Superman 2 was genius.
But the other thing with Superman is there wasn't that much Superman about when you were a kid.
He turned back time.
No real...
Because he found a way, you know? He found a way save Lois.
And like even as a kid, even at that time when I was pretty much just watching the Batman... the TV show from the 60s, and that was my reference point growing up.
So you were probably too old watching, you know, Channel 10, Channel 7 morning cartoon shows, weren't you?
Yeah.
Because you got a few years on me. And
I got 3 years on you, 4 years.
So you weren't buying into Agro's Cartoon Connection at all?
Oh, no, I was into Agro's. I was into Agro's.
Okay.
Yeah, I was into Agro's.
But, like, you got to understand, like, I thought this Batman animated series... like it was dark. Everything was noir in the stylings.
Was it Danny Elfman, the music?
No. Oh, that's a good question. I need to Google that one. But
yeah, I'm not sure.
Oh, the music was genius. The cartoon style was genius. It was all still hand drawn.
Yeah.
Everything had this sort of like airbrushed background thing. Yeah. So it was film noir but cartoon. Yeah.
And it was Mark Hamill, wasn't it, as the Joker?
Mark Hamill was the Joker, which a lot of people would know that.
Yeah.
And he just nailed it. He absolutely nailed the Joker's voice. But I liked, you know, characters like Clayface, which is one of the big characters, and I think it was actually a two-part episode.
Yeah.
But, you know, it was just the best cartoon.
I mean, I've had a really rough ride with superhero films. Like, both of my favourite characters, effectively. Well, the characters that I kind of like most is... Like, my favourite villain is the Riddler. Like, by miles over anyone else, which... You'll go, Riddler. I love the Riddler. He's the best. He's the most flawed, crazy...
Well, after playing a bit of Batman Arkham Asylum, I did enjoy the Riddler storyline in that game.
And maybe just because I've been exposed to so much Joker, you get... But I've always liked the Riddler more as a kid. Like when you're watching the TV shows, like there's always the Riddler, Penguin, and the Joker.
Yeah,
So when Jim Carrey completely destroyed the Riddler...
George
Clooney destroyed
that
Batman.
CSI Miami guy.
Arnie.
What's his name? Chris.
Caruso?
Chris
O'Donnell.
Chris O'Donnell. Oh.
The Robin.
CSI Miami Desert Storm or whatever it was.
The only good thing to come that era of film, they were the Joel Schumacher films, right?
Yeah.
Was that hot blonde chick with the lip back in the day? She had the curly lip, she was Batgirl.
Oh, Alicia Silverstone.
Alicia Silverstone.
That was the only good thing.
Clueless.
That bodysuit and Alicia Silverstone were made to be.
Especially the scenes where they zoom in and then putting the suits on.
That's the business.
Yeah.
That was the peak of Joel Schumacher.
only by that distinctive.
Yeah, but I mean, so many films have been ruined, like for me, mostly by Michael Bay. But fuck.
Michael Bay.
Hello, I'm Michael Bay.
Michael Bay. We'll talk about what Michael Bay has done to some other films.
We'll save that for another episode. Yeah.
Well, I want to go on a rant. I want to go on a rant about how a game studio got the look and feel of Transformers Devastation right.
Oh.
Yet somehow Michael Bay couldn't see the light and do that for his he would have been thrown money.
I think that's half the problem. He gets his blank checkbook and he goes, what am I going to do with this? Like, I can do this and it's perfect, but then I've got all these millions of dollars left. I might as well spend it.
Yeah. Let's make the robots look really complicated and nothing like the original toys. Thanks a lot, Hasbro, for letting that one get through. You know, the people at Hasbro have got a lot to answer for.
Now, while we're talking about toys.
Yes.
Star Wars is almost upon us.
Yep.
Star Wars Battlefront.
27 days.
Which we saw...
27 days.
We saw a bit of Battlefront today.
Yes, we did.
Opening day of its sale.
At EB today.
We were hovering around this poor 8-year-old kid in EB Games.
And we're putting the pressure on him. We're putting the pressure on him to shoot some stormtroopers.
He was.
And I bought a Star Wars t-shirt.
He did.
Which you're wearing now.
Which I'm wearing now. And I flirted a bit with the girl that...
No, he did. Yeah. I think she...
This chick wearing the R2-D2 top.
Gave you 25% discount.
Yeah, 25%
discount. I'll see you at the premiere.
Anyway, what are we all expecting to spend in merchandise with this new Star Wars?
Well, my first order of business in terms of merchandise will either some sort of, you know, cheap Coles, Woolworths, cheap toy.
Yes.
Or save up, and just get myself the Lego Millennium Falcon.
Mm.
I think it's about $200 or $300. But it is a magnificent piece of toy.
I had you pinned for that foam.
Yeah, I might get that one.
From that side.
The new foam lightsaber.
Was it Giz? Gilmoda or something?
No. Who was it? Who created it?
The
crowdfund one.
Yeah, the crowdfund on Kickstarter.
Yeah, but I think they're still...
Kickstarter, yeah.
I think they're still trying to iron out, like, production issues with it. Like, it's not like ready is.
Can't you pre-order from the?
Yeah, but if you the more money you spend, the better the lightsaber package they give you. So if you spend $500, you get the deluxe model, and like if you wave it around, it goes.
It has sound, yeah.
Got Bluetooth
and if it strikes someone, it's got that. But it's all intuitive, like sound. It's like they've worked out what it would sound like if it
looked really
behaved
weird,
that way.
Though it looked more like a blade than a circular.
They're going outside the brief a little bit because they're not. I don't think they're in Disney's pocket yet.
Yeah, but it was only one of them. The other one, the blue one, looked like it was a round circle.
Yeah.
But the red one looked like it had this blade along the back of it. But the app I really liked, where you could change the colour on your app and your phone.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
So, that was unbelievable. So that's got 2 weeks to go. I think.
So are we going to be putting a link to this video on?
All the links of stuff we're talking about in here will be in the show notes. So fear not.
So how much would one cost?
I can't remember.
Well, there's a base model which starts like $100. You give $100, you get the basic model. But the more you spend, the better the construction, the better the bang for buck you get. Yeah. So and obviously the most deluxe model has got all of that intuitive sound thing with it, which I think is fantastic.
I mean, I think from memory, they asked for $50,000 originally for the Kickstarter.
But didn't they get up to 73,000 or something?
Last night I was looking, I think they're over 90,000.
Yeah, because last I looked, it was 73,000. Yeah. So that's pretty good. Yeah.
So I fear for them in terms of copyright with Disney, they would have
done their research. Yeah. Surely they would have done their research before going.
Did
you see those two guys?
Neck minute.
Did you see those two guys? I don't know.
I
think they just did it.
Where are they from? Sweden or something?
Yeah,
one was
Sweden
French
or
something as well. Yeah. No,
France.
They're both French.
I think they were either French or they were French Canadian.
Okay.
I think they were one.
Yeah.
Hey, we got this lightsaber, eh?
They just looked like guys who did it because they loved it with no real thought of. Oh yeah, we'll make a heap of these for people, and then.
But if that
probably pre-Disney that started.
See, I think
because back in the day, George Lucas would have said, "Yeah, fine."
Yeah, he would have been
because he says yes to.
But my only roadblock with it would be, I reckon Disney going, well, you're actually hitting someone with something, and you know, like. Are you allowed to do that with toys? I mean, I know you can.
But
still, the idea is that. It's encouraging you to hit someone with it, and I don't know if is that too much.
Well, you're not encouraging someone to hit with it. The entire.
But they do have the plastic ones, and people still hit each other with those.
Yeah, I know.
The purpose of a lifesaver is actually to cut someone in half. So let's not neglect that.
My friend doesn't like you.
But I mean, like, I'm seeing a lot of hours going down the toilet for me with Battlefront. I don't know about you guys, but I'm done. I think. There's no point in me buying any other game for 6 months.
No,
I'll be done.
And that's when their servers will be most busy too. Like in terms of online.
Yeah. I fear. Yeah. I hope they're not with the same servers that I'm dealing with at the moment.
Mm.
Otherwise, there'll be
hell to pay.
Hell to pay. If I can't connect into a match, I'm going to march in to Disney.
Yeah. You're going to march.
I'm going to march.
Are you going to be dressed as...
I'm going to march up and down the plane.
Are you going to be...
I'm going to keep marching until I...
You're about as tall as Captain Phasma, so you're going to wear her chrome Stormtrooper armor?
Oh, I don't know. I might put on... Seeing as they're not using it anymore, I might put on the Princess Leia copper skin. Bar and this.
Skin tone t-shirt, yeah.
Seeing as I've got rid of that, I'm going to bring it back. I'm going to march into Disney and I'm going to say, no. Get your servers right,
mate.
Well, I'm not really a super avid gamer, but I did have Street Fighter 4 and I did play that online on Xbox Live for a little bit. But it was crazy playing people online with Street Fighter. Actually, because of the connection, actually physically slows your machine down just to keep up with the frame data that you're inputting into the game. So I'm like, how's what? Why?
Yeah, I don't know.
It's because of our copper networks.
Yeah, Malcolm Turnbull. If you were listening right now,
I'm sure he's listening. I'm sure.
Malcolm, too, he could be listening. Fiver to the home. Fiver to the home.
Dig up all the copper. Melt, make more money melting the copper down.
What are we in ancient Rome? Still paying for things in copper? What's going on?
I could get faster data through an underground aquifer.
Put a cabinet in your toilet and sort your shit out.
Damn straight. Now, whilst we're talking about Disney, rumours of Indiana Jones 5, Jono. With Harrison Ford. Should they reboot or should they go with Harrison Ford?
No, I think they should reboot.
Harrison Ford needs to be in a Sean Connery type.
I don't think that he could pull off the stunts.
He doesn't need to do stunts. Because
I was thinking CGI the stunts and he camera rolls.
No, he's going to play like a grandfather figure, like his father before him.
I reckon they've got to try and bring somebody new now.
A new protagonist.
Chris Pratt would be perfect for the role.
Has he redeemed himself with his recent antics?
No, he just needs to stay away.
No, he's a performance artist now.
He's a performance artist?
Yeah.
I reckon bring Harrison Ford back and then maybe kill him off.
Yeah.
And then get Chris Pratt to...
Chris Pratt could be anyone and he just happens to be a treasure hunter
He could play Shia LaBeouf's role, but just recast.
I don't think Spielberg will let that roll.
He'd come back as Mud.
Mud,
that was his name, remember? That was one of the most annoying things. His name was Mud, whatever, that he called himself in that fifth film, Crystal Skulls.
Fourth film?
Fourth? Fifth. We're talking about the fifth. I'm getting confused. The fourth.
Not
the
one,
Skulls.
Not two, thrice. Indiana Jones, thrice.
Thrice. And yes, four. The Crystal Skulls. He was Mud something. I don't know. I cut out so much of that film in my mind.
Why would you go with aliens when you could have gone Atlantis or something, you know?
Well,
or a lost city somewhere, you know?
Yeah, well, I think they may have...
That's what they did in Uncharted. It worked for them.
Apparently there was a very good Atlantis script at one point that they kiboshed in the end.
For Indiana Jones?
For four. They're looking at scripts for four, and then they went with...
Lucas is going to have giant ants in four.
That was...
then Steel Spielberg was...
What, like 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea giant ants?
Yeah. Oh. The thing that most annoyed me that I found out a few weeks ago watching the Back in Time documentary about the making of Back to the Future.
No, I watched that. That was good.
Yeah, and... There were some screenwriters in there talking about how they're going through the script and how there was a scene in one of the Back to the Future films with a flying fridge that went out from a nuclear explosion and whatever. But they cut it because it was stupid. Steven Spielberg, they said, I'll cut it because it's stupid. Then he brought it back,
because
he hates his fans. He brought it back when that nuclear explosion at the start of Indiana Jones...
He provokes rage quitting amongst his fans just to get more publicity.
I almost walked out of the cinema at that point. I actually had higher hopes up to that point. I thought the opening scene for the Russians, and they kind of had that washed-out colour. Yeah.
The first 20 minutes of four was genius.
Yeah.
And then it got progressively worse as you got to know some of the characters a bit more.
I think it had peaks and troughs.
Yeah.
It was that point with the flying fridge. There was the point...
It's Cate Blanchett.
Worst performance she's probably ever
made. Because they
need a good villain they're going to do five.
She was playing such a caricature and it was so fake. Yeah. It was really hard to watch.
And Jono raises a good point there. Villains.
There's not enough good villains.
Like villains in an Atlantis thing. You're gonna have to be chasing.
Yeah. Like lost tribe, lost, you know, it could have been potentially really good.
I mean, like, the problem is, I think a good storyline like Pandora's Box was stolen away by Tomb Raider, the second Tomb Raider film.
There's a reboot coming for that too.
Oh, there is.
Yeah.
Oh.
Let's talk about that maybe.
We'll talk about that. Yeah. All right. Yeah, but, so Harrison Ford, yay or nay, Jimbo?
Well, if he takes on a Sean Connery type, grandfather type, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what that would work.
He's still in the film, but in a more incapacitated version, and let Chris Pratt do all of the whipping and
in a wheelchair.
It doesn't have to be a wheelchair.
Like it could start out where he's exploring, and then he meets in an accident,
Yeah.
And then Chris Pratt comes to meet him.
And then and then he's got Professor X's chair for the rest of the film.
And they shave his head.
He doesn't have much hair up there anymore. Yeah. Oh. You reckon he's wearing a wig in The Force Awakens?
No. Still got hair.
I really want a pure reboot of Indiana Jones.
Like start again?
No.
Young Indiana Jones.
Use the canon, but start telling another... I'd like another trilogy of new
films. Yeah, but... hang on. Like, young Indiana Jones was on TV like when we were growing up in the 90s, So... I don't have. I'm assuming it's on DVD somewhere. I've never hunted it down to get it. Yeah. But from memory, I remember the production values of Young Indiana Jones is pretty amazing.
Yes.
For what it was.
Well, for a TV.
From what I can remember,
it was amazing.
Yet, it seems to be lost in the ether of the 90s. It seems to be.
Well, it was. Yeah. I don't know how good the show actually was. I mean, it's very difficult.
Like, I've got more stinging memories of Saved by the Bell than I do Young Indiana Jones, and that bothers me.
Yeah, yeah.
Who was in the role?
Of Young Indiana Jones? I think it was River. Was it River Phoenix? No, he was Young Indiana Jones in one of the films.
In one of the
intro of the film. Like, I can't remember who played in the TV show.
But whatever, it doesn't matter. At the end of the day, it was... High-end production values for what it was.
No, we're going to have a look at this. We're going to find out.
May I have a drink, Charles?
Yes, you may.
We're going to find out who Young Indiana Jones was. We're going to the IMDb machine. Let's have a look at this damn thing. Not 1992.
Well, I was 12 years old then, eh? 12 years old? Oh, sorry, Jono.
Mate.
Let's have a look who this was. It was Indiana Jones with Sean Patrick Flannery.
What's some of his other work then?
He used to work at a diner in East LA.
No, movie roles, young Carlos.
He was in... what's he been... what's been completed here? He's completed work...
Wasn't he a martial artist?
Is in Kepler's Dream.
Never heard of it.
The Storyteller...
Rings a bell.
Oh, no, these are all in post-production, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
He's got a lot of post-production.
Oh, he was in the Boondock Saints. The Boondock Saints with...
Boondock Saints?
Yeah.
Oh, he's in The Phantom?
Oh.
Another shit film that really disappointed me.
But... Brendan Fraser's a good casting choice, though, don't you think?
Yes, but The Phantom was the comic book that I read most as a kid.
Really?
Like, that was my most...
I was more of a Foot Trot Flats Garfield.
And to this day, I'm still a Foot Trot Flats Garfield. I still don't know why, actually.
Because it was there. In every milk bar.
And you always got really good value.
Yeah.
Always really it was, sick.
That's, it was like Mad Comics. It was everywhere.
Yeah.
And maybe Viz Comics too, but...
Who owns The Phantom?
Is it DC?
No. I think it's someone completely different.
I can't even remember. Like, but I would love DC or Marvel to take it.
I think it's another comic that's owned by DC. Is it?
So it might be another comic book label that's owned by DC.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Because I haven't read or looked for The Phantom.
I've seen The Phantom Pokey Machine at Crank Casino.
I've still got a big stack of Phantom.
Have you played The Phantom Pokey Machine at Crown?
No, I have not.
No, it's next to the Lex Luthor / Superman Pokey Machines.
Oh, he was in The Young and the Restless. So you would know him.
No, I wasn't a Young and the Restless person. I was more of a Days of Our Lives. Like sands through the hourglass. These are the days of our lives.
Yeah, geez, he's in CSI. That really pretty much...
Sorry, Carl, I'm team Marlena and...
Are you?
Yeah, Stefano, yeah.
Oh. Wow.
Sorry about that.
He was in Charmed. That was one of my favourite TV shows of all time.
Hang on.
Pretty much chicks, you're not much doing to each other.
Yeah.
And also, there was a character that they introduced later in the piece that went on to be a major character in something else.
What was this?
In Charmed.
Yeah, like real late season, they introduced a new...
Oh, there was...
what was her
she
name?
She was girlfriend with... what was her name?
What was her name?
While Carl's thinking, we'll try and find some music to...
people listening right now are yelling out at us through this.
Yeah, yeah.
To the Google machine.
My soon-to-be wife will know the answer to that question.
She was going out with Marilyn Manson, I think, for a while. That is my memory.
Alyssa Milano?
No, not Alyssa Milano, the fourth one.
Oh, Rose McGowan.
Rose McGowan.
Yeah, McGowan, yes.
That actually brought the show back to life for me. She is my favourite out of those.
How many seasons did they go for?
Ooh.
Pretty long.
Ooh, yeah. Ooh. I'm going to have to bring that up, but it seemed like a lot because it petered out towards the end.
So, hang on. So you're saying that you liked Charms like some people like Buffy, but Charms.
Sorry, I'll take that. I like Buffy up to the point where it got weird when they started introducing Spike, and it just went. You're a yes to Harrison Ford.
I'm a yes, where you bring him for a certain time, and then
I'm a no.
Chris Pratt takes over.
I'm a no. Now the other little point of another great trilogy from our time. Is Back to the Future. Now, the story about Back to the Future 4.
No, don't touch it.
Just no, you can't. It's like doing Tron again. You just don't do it.
Well, I don't know how you could do it without Michael Jackson.
I'd like to see a Last Starfighter reboot, though. That needs a bit of a reboot.
I would love that. I think that's
because that could be epic.
Underrated.
That could be epic.
Yeah, highly underrated.
Very epic.
You can't do it without Michael J. Fox. You can't do it without Christopher Lloyd.
Well, Christopher Lloyd's keen to do it.
But he's too old now.
But you'd almost
he'd still play a good mad scientist. That's for sure.
Robert Zemeckis has said that as long as he's alive, nothing's going to happen to him.
Yeah. Exactly. Like he doesn't want to do it. He doesn't want to do
it.
Okay. He owns the rights, doesn't he?
Yeah. He does. He doesn't want to do it. The only way they could do it was to have them as. Older people and Michael J. Fox's kids go back and
That's what they always do with all the sequels.
Look, this is what Disney have foreseen. They have foreseen it.
Yes.
They've foreseen that, okay, let's get some young blood into the franchise so that we can do something with it for the next 30 to 50 years.
Is that owned by Disney?
Force Awakens. I'm talking about
now. Force Awakens. We've gone back like 45 minutes.
I'm using them as an example because I think that I can tell they're going to get it right because you know, even if Lando does make a surprise appearance, you know, that would be great or whatnot, but the characters are going to have to, you know, pass away eventually. But if you've got all
new...
We're
not travelling back in time.
Unless they
do live forever.
All you
need is a Mr. Fusion and a flux capacitor. You can make these films forever.
If they do, who could replace Michael J. Fox?
Michael J. Fox.
He's unreplaceable. He's a
pretty unique.
And Michael J. Fox in The Hard Way is one of the best 80s movies I've seen that I hadn't seen in the 80s.
Yeah.
With what's the guy's the bad guy the cop in The Hard Way. He was on Family Guy a lot.
Peter Griffin?
No. No.
Stewie?
No, not Stewie.
Brian?
No.
Hey, Brian.
Steven
they named, they James, named James a school. Woods? James Woods.
James Woods.
So James Woods played a hard-hitting cop.
Yeah.
Right. He played a hard-hitting cop, and Michael J. Fox had to work with him for the police force to research a role for an upcoming movie because Michael J. Fox... played this super duper Hollywood mega actor of the 80s. And that's the premise of the film, is that James Woods is a real cop, Michael J. Fox is the Hollywood star, and he has to work with James Woods. It is the most amazing 80s film. I was surprised to see.
You've got a replacement.
I've got a perfect replacement for Michael J. Fox.
Who?
And it would tie in beautifully with the history of the films.
Okay.
We go with Eric Stoltz again.
Nah.
Eric Stoltz.
Well, he was the original Marty McFly.
But they got rid of him.
Yeah, because he was shit. But
he's still shit.
But he could come back. If you watch the footage in that documentary, when you see the Eric Stoltz footage, it's like, oh, thank God.
Yeah.
Thank God they did that. Because it looked, even what he was wearing, his outfit was really dark.
Yeah.
Like, it just wasn't right.
He didn't have the comedic presence as Michael J. Fox.
He's not a funny guy. He's a good actor. Like one of my friends lists Eric Stoltz as one of his exemptions. Like if he were to sleep with a man, it would be Eric.
No.
I mean, like, he has been in some good films, Eric Stoltz. But could we do that? Could we? I don't see how there's any chance for.
Well, where's Biff Tannen fall into all of this?
Biff Tannen, he's still polishing cars down there.
I'm just putting the second coat on now. Yeah. Mr. McFly.
Biff.
Now, Biff.
Now. Don't calm me. We had to do that. Sorry.
Sorry, we had to do that.
Yeah.
Now, don't calm me, Biff.
I am your density.
Yeah, so I guess, yeah. Yeah. I don't think they should touch it.
No.
Just don't touch it.
Yeah, you can't. No. That's the one thing you can't touch. And I think just out of respect, I think.
How long do we give them? At a certain point in time in the future.
How about the
video is going to go.
Here's an idea. How about screenwriters and writers come up with something original that either perhaps may paraphrase the Back to the Future canon and give it a new, like someone steals the time machine because it's been in a barn for 50 years, set it in the future and create a whole new
universe.
New universe because someone plugged Mr. Fusion back in and accidentally went back in time. It'd be like, Keanu Reeves and that blonde guy. Well, Mom.
This is just studio crazy talk. Why don't we just spend like half the money and do exactly what these other films did, and then we've got a guaranteed audience no matter how shit they are. Which is pretty much what
Do you like the idea of someone stealing the DeLorean, though? From the old... Because it's back in the old days, yeah? But it would probably end up in a barn because...
I would have no problems in a future reboot if they replace the DeLorean with a vehicle suitable for that time.
What?
Because the DeLorean was like the futuristic vehicle. Of
but the DeLorean's the only thing that's the time machine.
So like, have it like a Tesla or some...
You're saying they find the DeLorean, they rip out the Mr. Fusion and the flux capacitor and put it in a Tesla and it's bankrolled by Tesla.
No more DeLorean. No more DeLorean.
A new car for the new generation.
Where we're going, we don't need people.
We don't need DeLoreans.
How about Holden?
Nah. A Holden Vault.
Yeah.
Look,
things are a bit sleek and weird looking.
Yeah. Because I kind of like what
Prius.
The Prius. But you need those wing doors.
Yeah.
That's the one iconic thing from the car that would have to stay. If they replace the car,
it'd got to have like a Mercedes gull wing sort of thing. Yeah. But do you like that idea though? Like someone steals it, that's the story arc, and you can allow you to forget about all the old people. Maybe Christopher Lloyd could come back in some capacity,
a cameo,
perhaps a cameo, but just have fresh cast, get good screenwriters to not stuff it up, and. I reckon that could really work.
If you ran a story with someone...
And then it's still called Back to the Future, but you're not ruining the original...
If you found something where they found... Okay, let's say they found DeLorean 60 years' time.
Yeah, in a barn.
They went back.
In a barn. Yeah. Let's just say it's in a barn.
But they went back to now where Christopher Lloyd is now in his 70s or 80s.
Yeah, and he's still married to that lady.
And they've got to get plutonium, whatever, the plastic capacitor back.
And it's his kids that have to save the day and steal back the time machine.
You know what would be perfect for this?
And then they have to go back in time, like they did, to. And then there's multiple time-jumping storylines because they could use old footage from the original trilogy... To not, you know, you could really.
I don't know whether they could, because even Zemeckis has said some of that footage even he admits some of his shoots in that, if he looks at them now, he doesn't like them because they're a little bit out of focus.
Mm. What?
Which, when you're filming in HD cameras,
it's going to be
a marked difference.
But look, it's not going to look like Episode 1 Star Wars where it looks fake. They're really good at recreating stuff now.
You'd virtually have to film it on the same equipment. But what I was going to say, go back to what we did. What if they waited to make the Back to the Future reboot until hoverboards were real?
Oh,
yeah.
That would be good.
Market the entire
Well, they're kind of real now. The Lexus
well,
one.
They're fake. Yeah. Real.
No, no, but this one really floats on anything.
Oh, does it?
But it's about that much. Like half.
Yeah, but you need a metal surface.
No, no, no.
No?
The Lexus one just goes off the ground.
Oh, does it? Is that real?
No.
Yeah,
it's real.
No, it's a fake skate park.
No, the Lexus one.
No, the Lexus one?
Yeah.
All right,
no.
We're going to come back in episode two and we're going
to. We'll do some research. We'll do some research.
We're going to battle this out.
Yeah, all right.
Now, whilst we're talking about the future, in recent days, there's been news of Amazon and the likes are now sending out all their packages using drones, artificial intelligence.
Ooh.
Has that been implemented?
I think in the US, yeah. You get deliveries with drones.
Did Australia Post say something about drones recently, too, in the news?
Drones are going to rule the world.
Imagine if they send the drones to Dubton and shit.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. They're going to bloody have little guns and bones, like a cap in your ass. Rebel. Welcome back to Rebel Scum Radio. It is now time for the special segment everyone's been waiting for.
That they don't know about.
That they don't know about, yeah. Yeah, we didn't put it in the intro. We should have. Then they could have waited.
But that's
for
part of waiting. The surprise, yeah.
Then they would have listened to this show without coming to this point in the show.
They've turned off by now. Yeah, they've actually tuned out.
Yeah, they have to.
What are these rambling Australians?
What are these rambling people doing?
Bloody but Australians.
Australians.
It is time for everything in biscuit news and hamburger news with what grinds Jim Bob's teeth.
All right. Okay. So, right. Okay. So, you know, as a kid, you know, you grow up with Kingston biscuits. You grow up with the family assortment, you know, range and that, and they tend to be good memories from your childhood and that, and then you growing up through the years into adulthood, and then the crushing reality of buying biscuits from the shop becomes apparent when you see the size of things dissipate.
Sometimes the biscuits turn on you.
Yeah, the biscuits turn.
The biscuits turn.
And yeah, so, like, I had this favourite biscuit when I was a kid, and it goes by the name of Iced Vovo.
We should premise this again that we're from Australia, so...
It's all Australian brands.
So this is all Australian
Aussie brands.
I don't know where the Iced Vovo is.
Arnott's.
Is that generally Australian?
I don't know. Well, it's Arnott's. That's Australian.
I saw Tim Tams in California, and they were like $6.
Oh, were they?
Ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh, another Aussie icon. That, mate, you're big in the States.
The Dingo Stole My Baby Bar, was it?
Yeah. Dingo edition.
It's you, Jackman, Nicole Kidman, and the Tim Tam.
Skate or die.
You're all making it big in the States.
So, so when I was...
And by the way, to Arnott's, we're open for sponsorships. Anyway,
yeah, but this doesn't paint them in a good light. So, yeah, you know, like Iced Vovos when I was a kid, like they'd have big marshmallow, pink marshmallow, 8 dots marshmallows on the biscuit. And in the middle, it had like 4, you know, healthy dollops of raspberry Kool-Aid, you know, jelly-like substance. slash burp. Burp. Burps.
Some kind of red jam.
Red jam. Yeah, burping.
There's red jam, marshmallows and coconut on a biscuit.
Coconut. Yeah, that's right. They dust the coconut on the marshmallow bits. Yeah. So, yeah, and just underneath it just had this, you know, this sort of dunkable, you know, straightforward Marie biscuit type thing underneath. But the ratio was correct.
Yes.
Because the amount of marshmallow, the amount of raspberry Kool-Aid, the amount of biscuit when munched upon was the right ratio.
And now,
I can't buy this biscuit at the shops now because that's like someone took all the air out of the marshmallow and they deflated.
They are they seem to be quite crunchy.
And you get a tiny, instead of a red Kool-Aid dot, it's like a red Kool-Aid disc, but saturated with like
they're
all
ripped
these. They ripped it out. They've ripped out all the flavour and replaced it with synthetic, fake, synthesized flavours. So, but even it's still they taste like chemicals.
To me,
whereas back when you're a kid, they actually made let's use real food derivatives.
What about the Tim Tams?
Oh, we'll get to the Tim Tams.
Yeah, but the Iced Vovo now is like the biscuit's thinner. There's less on top. They're like pressed down so they can fit more into a pack.
Yeah, but that...
They taste horrible.
Yeah, and it's like...
Sorry,
sorry. and it's a shame because it's like, you know, and this will lead into how I feel about Tim Tams because I think the Tim Tams... Because the Tim Tams are a pretty damn good biscuit. Like
and
it's,
whilst we're trans, we need to clear it. Tim Tam is like the Australian Oreo. It's classic.
Yeah, and it was
you bite one end, then you bite the other end, and you drink
drink the coffee through it, or hot chocolate,
So if anyone's in LA and they can buy Tim Tams,
you can try that.
Try that out.
Yeah.
The one and all you got to say the one that Hugh Jackman was talking about on Jimmy Fallon, you know.
Yes.
And they go, oh yeah, 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 that one. Yeah.
But they're getting the shitty second rate version.
Yeah. Well, not necessarily. I mean, they probably ship it over from well,
true. They could be getting all of the good ones, and we're left with
yeah. Them. We're left with the
that's why $6.
The,
yeah.
We're
like
left.
They're getting export quality. Yeah.
We get the ones that fall onto the ground when they're being spat out of the machines at a million miles an hour. The Australians get the ones that fall on the floor, but all the good ones they go to the yeah. LA directly yeah. to LA.
They got all of our Tim Tams and Fosters.
I'm not worried about Foster's not being here. That's okay in my book. But yeah, so Tim Tam's like, you know, like again, you know, it's the ratio. Oh, I'm talking about ratios here. There's two biscuits, the sort of like the hazelnut praline, chocolate praline in the middle, yeah, and a decent licking of melted chocolate over the top, and it's fantastic. And now, you know, you get the good old Tim Tams and you're biting into it and going, yeah, not enough chocolate. Not enough chocolate on my biscuit. But for the same price, and this is what I don't get, for the same price, you can get double coat. Same biscuit, same everything.
Are they the same as your biscuit double coats?
I think the conspiracy is that that's what they the original ones were, but they've just called it double coat.
Okay.
So this
is like the Foster's Crown Lager rumor. I'm sorry, the BB.
They use special things to take the top off. Which is probably bullshit, but yeah.
So you're paying more for the biscuit you always used to get.
Yeah, but I don't know. I'm confused because they seem to be. They seem to be the same price at the shop, so I don't get. Yeah, but we're getting into marketing. That's just marketing. Yeah. But well, it's like, let's take away what people love, and then we'll make them buy the double coat because they, because it's the same price.
This is one of my greatest hates of the Tim Tam, is that they've actually got biscuits that are nothing like a Tim Tam. Like white chocolate Tim Tams.
I love the white chocolate one.
But they're not a Tim Tam. They've just got a Tim Tam label on it, and they're the same shape. Like a Tim Tam's one specific bit.
Yeah, they're just
because they got the caramel now. They got the strawberry.
But
it's just as easier for them to brand it a Tim Tam. Yeah, than some look, other biscuit. Yeah.
Look, I'm all for experimentation. Fine, dark chocolate Tim Tams. I get it. Yeah. People like dark chocolate. Yeah. You know, I don't know why they haven't done an old gold Tim Tam yet. Because rum and raisin Tim Tam. Like this
rum and raisin. Get out of here.
That there could be potential.
Get out.
Hey, look.
There's no room for rum and raisin.
Well, I'm a tragic old gold rum raisin fan, so I could eat that in a biscuit any day.
Drink a little shot of sherry every night before you go.
Perhaps I do. But
in front of your
pipeline, but what I find disappointing about all the experimental flavors, like it's fine that they do it, but why make the flavors, come across as a bit synthetic? And I don't want to disrespect Adriana Zumbo because I think his salted caramel Tim Tam is potentially a work of art.
I've actually never had a Zumbo dessert. I really shouldn't try.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's just in South Yarra. It's not hard to get to. And his stuff's prima. And obviously, he's doing his thing with Tim Tam and that. But it's just a shame that the original Tim Tam tastes so good, because it's chocolate. Yeah. But all these experimental red velvet flavors and white chocolate this and that they do come across.
When did they stop making like the original Tim Tam?
Well, I don't know. It's like I said, it's morphed into the double coat.
Yeah, but it's because
it's just
things.
A marketing, it's,
kind of
it's
like,
a marketing ploy.
It's kind of like Fritto Frogs. They've shrunk to an incredibly small size.
They're small too, aren't they? And the amount of caramel in a caramel koala, I don't think there's as much caramel as there used to be.
Like, as far as I'm concerned, Fritto owes me a fair bit of money. Because he's been getting bored under false pretenses of being
where are the Birdie Beetles? Why do I have to wait for the Melbourne show to get a Birdie Beetle?
The Birdie Beetles still exist.
Yeah, in show bag form. Show bag form. I don't think so, yeah.
Another great Aussie...
Maybe at a $2 shop, maybe, but, with all of those rock lollies they sell at $2 shops. No disrespect, but they're a bit rock lollies.
It'd be a great party outfit, actually.
What? Goes the Freddo.
Where you're a birdie beetle. Like just out of tinfoil.
You know one of the greatest memories I have as a kid is when birthday time came around in my family.
Yeah.
At the end of every birthday, it was family tradition to play this game called... it was like a birdie beetle game.
Mm.
Basically, I think it was like... I don't know if you rolled dice or something or played music. I just can't remember it. But everyone had a drawing pad that had a picture of a birdie beetle. And there was this game where you had to draw something or some kind of birdie beetle game. I'll research it and give you the... I'll try and remember to talk about it next time. But yeah, like that because Birdie Beetle used to be a big brand. That wasn't Small Fry, you know. That used to be competing with Freddo.
Wasn't just an Australian brand. That wasn't.
I'm pretty sure it was. Beetle. Yeah, because it's all like local chocolate makers in Melbourne and stuff.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I mean, you know what a pity the rest of the world don't have caramello koalas. I mean, I'm
why?
Sure they've got something else. What? I'm not going to care about
caramel. Oh yeah, because of koala. Yeah. It's probably like that. Was it? What was that? Animal Friends chocolate that they used to have at supermarkets that had all the wallabies on it. And what was that? That was Cadbury, wasn't it?
They were always great though. They were always really good.
That was good chocolate, and they were wrapped in silver.
Yeah.
And then
it was actually foil.
Oh, it was foil silver. Silver foil. Clarification, silver foil.
They weren't wrapped in silver. Yeah.
But and that was before Yowies came about. Instead of collecting Yowies, you collect
they're a Yowie chocolate.
Yeah, but the
Yowies came inside a chocolate.
Yowies
egg
kind of
thing.
Got inspired after the Kinder Surprises
But that was spearheaded by Cadbury doing the Friends of Australian native animal, like they'd have all the wallabies and the numbats and the drop bears. And
even though 5% of
drop bears.
Even though 5% of every Freddo may contain traces of wallaby. Anyway, your last. I know you've got a last gear. I saw you eat one this afternoon for dinner. The size of the Big Mac.
Yeah, well, okay, so...
And I don't know if this is a global phenomenon.
No,
it is a global one.
Look, I don't know if I'm getting bigger and taller, but I got a feeling that the Big Mac's getting smaller and smaller. And reason being is like you know, Big Macs and quarter pounders used to come in foam...
Yeah.
Indestructible foam vessels.
Yeah. They're in landfills all around Melbourne.
They had incredible floating ability, especially in the Yarra. They floated very well in the Yarra. Yeah. So much so that little families of rats could live in the Big Mac, flotation devices down the Yarra.
You just saw big Mac packs floating against the bodies.
The rats could go quicker than the yachts and the Wesley College. Yeah, what are those racing teams that they do the boats boat racing?
The head of the river.
Yeah. They were like a hazard for
I mean, if you're ever trapped on an island somewhere,
I don't know.
You just hope that all those plastic.
We're not. Look, anyway.
Then you can float all the way home.
If I tie all these Big Mac vessels together, I could float the entire length of the Yarra River.
I just strap them to my body.
And you use like all those straws stuck together as your paddle.
Jesus Christ.
He's losing it.
He is.
But yeah, I feel like when I eat a Big Mac now, it feels like I've just eaten a cheeseburger.
Could you just eat it in two bites?
Oh, no, I don't want to eat a Big Mac in two bites, but it's not that same satisfaction.
I think the noticeable difference is that the Hungry Jack's Whopper has not changed in size and that's full size.
I thought Bacon Deluxes used to be a bit bigger than
I'm not sure.
They are now, so
Most weeks, I think we're going to do paranormal stories, boys. Don't know, not sure. But if we've got listener stories, they can send us in some cool stories about...
Yeah, just get onto the website and...
Yeah, get on the website, rebelscumradio.com. We've got a contact us form.
If you like shopping at the haunted bookshop in Melbourne, maybe you might want to send in a letter because we'd love to hear from you.
Yeah, if you've got any stories about black-eyed kids or ghosts or time slips.
Yowies.
Yeah,
drop yowies.
Drop yowies. Ferocious Australian.
Man-eating. Ferocious. Man-eating, drop yowies.
And UFOs and alien abductions.
Yeah, why not?
All that kind of stuff.
Yeah,
incubus stories too.
Yeah. Any stories that have anything to do with paranormal?
Send it in.
Send it in. Or if you've got any ideas for any topics you wanted to cover that maybe you haven't heard before.
Like what? Like shortwave radio? Weird things you heard on shortwave radio?
What, you
maybe
mean like contact?
Longwave, shortwave radio.
Dad's contacting me on shortwave radio.
Yes.
He died 30 years ago. Oh. any of that kind of stuff. Any of that. But today...
Number stations.
Today we're talking about time slips.
Yes.
And
we've been talking about it for a couple of weeks.
Yeah, me and Jono have been talking time slips. And all the weird paranormal stuff for quite a while.
Yeah.
And we've created the run sheet for this show. Oh, we're going to cover some time.
But I didn't mention to Carl that it happened to me twice when I was a kid.
Yeah, what kind of... You think you know a guy? You think you know a guy?
You think you know.
I saved it for the podcast.
That's the one thing we've been saying around the office quite a bit. We've been having these conversations and it's like, stop. Save it for the podcast.
Yes.
So time slips is when, like, you're going through a daily life and then suddenly...
Yeah, your reality changes in like a change in the heart.
But you're saying you're going into the future, you're moving forward.
I'd say I moved into.
you're slipping into like
another dimension.
Another dimension of time. So if there's rivers of time,
you've slipped into it, and then
slip into another time,
and then you come back.
You come back to your time.
You always come back to.
Well, he came back. We don't know whether
are you slipping forward in time or backward in time.
It's hard to know because you kind of don't know because like there could be an alternate timeline that to us
but it's still in the same place though.
So you're in the same space.
Yeah,
in a different time. So like a different timeline, like another Melbourne right now in a different timeline could look like the Melbourne from 30 years ago.
It could even be like 5 minutes or maybe 10 years.
Yeah.
Wow.
So it looks like it's from a different time zone. So you could think you're in like the 1920s, but it's just because the timelines
That gives deja vu a bit of legs then, doesn't it?
Well, I've got a theory on deja vu, which I'm going to share with people in...
Next episode.
Because it's a long, complicated one.
Okay.
And it actually involves time machines and YouTube. So keep...
Time machines on
YouTube.
Yes. Time machines on YouTube.
This is my theory. But anyway, back to Jono.
Yeah, Jono, tell us more.
Yeah, so little kid. I think I'm going to call him Charles. Cause,
Charles?
Yeah.
Where the future, Charles?
It might be quite awkward if he listens to this and he's like, you didn't tell me this shit.
I'm Rick James.
You're James, bitch.
I'm Rick James.
Yeah, little fella. We went on a little family trip. There were other people around.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was spending my time in the pool, flapping around. Next minute, this guy starts shouting at me. Charles starts shouting at me.
Yeah.
What the hell, lady? I was like, I didn't do anything. I was just standing here.
Just standing here.
Yeah, and then another person joins him and says, yeah, what the hell were you doing? I was like, no, nothing.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, an alternative you.
Did something.
So, your timelines must have crossed over.
Yeah.
Where he was doing something, you crossed over there, and then you crossed back.
Because I know for a fact that I was just sitting there, just flapping in the water.
Wow.
And then...
Unless they're easily annoyed.
From me flapping in the water?
Just flapping in the water. Stop flapping in the water!
But they wouldn't go crazy.
Yeah, they wouldn't go crazy. Yeah, so there was an alternative you doing something.
Doing something,
That really annoyed me.
Yeah.
That's time slips.
So when we're talking about time slips, there's obviously a lot of stories out there, anecdotal accounts of people's
There are stories where people have gone, this group that went to a cemetery.
Oh, yes.
And they came back and they spoke to this guy in the town. And the guy said, oh, that place is underwater. It's been in the lake for like ages.
Yeah, whoa. But I think I remember that story and... They were actually, whilst they were actually in the church, they were actually in the church, and whilst they were there, they could see it like kind of aging
the space was closing in.
Yeah, yeah.
And she saw the grave of the guy's sister.
Yeah.
She mentioned the name as, oh, that's my sister. She's been dead for years.
Yeah.
Wow.
It was really full on story. But there's lots of other really good time slip stories as well. And I think we should watch one on YouTube. And it's called The Man from Tower Head. Now, this is a story from Tokyo in 1954 of a man from a country that doesn't exist, but who had an official passport.
What was the name of the country?
It was Tower Head.
Tower Head.
T-A-U-R-E-D. Tower Head.
Right.
So you reckon the past or the future?
I think it's a dimensional shift where he's from another dimension where that country exists. And at some point where...
But he knows about Earth.
He knows that the Earth that he's from, effectively, the principality of Andorra is called Tower Head.
And they never found him again, did they?
No. He went to the airport.
Yeah.
He landed in Tokyo Airport. So he got through customs at Tower Head.
How did he get into the airport?
Hey?
How did he get into the airport?
Into the airport?
Yeah.
He must have been able to leave either whatever country he left from. Yep. So let's say in reality he's from Tower Head.
Yep.
He would have left Tower Head and gone through with his passport from Tower Head and got on the plane. At some point where he went through from customs to landing in Tokyo, he suffered a dimensional shift. Yeah. So he was now he had now shifted into an Earth where Tower Head didn't exist and was replaced with Andorra. So he's landed in Tokyo Airport at 1954. He's gone up to customs. He's presented his passport from Tower Head, and they've gone, "What is this?" Now the passport is stamped with times he's visited other countries in Europe,
and they're the ones that we know of Europe.
He had currency on him from the other countries in Europe, like from Spain and France and all the others. It's only this country of Tower Head that is different.
Did he have any currency from Tower Head?
From my understanding, he didn't.
Did they have an insignia of the flag or whatever?
Yeah, but he had a passport, an official-looking passport. And you know what passports look like. They're kind of canvassy, leathery. Yeah. So he had one of those. And that had been officially stamped 5 or 6 times from his other visits to Tokyo. So it had official stamps in it. Now,
So Tokyo did exist in the other image.
Yeah, so he was going to Tokyo for business reasons. He was a businessman. So he got to Tokyo and... He's got his passport. This country doesn't exist. What's this? And customs took him out. And he just goes, "What is this? This is fake. What's going on?" And he was very confused. He didn't know what was going on.
What do you look like? Like he's...
He's just a normal Caucasian, just European guy. Mm-hmm. Like, just a regular looking guy. Like, there's nothing outstanding about him.
What about his clothes?
His clothes were just regular, like they weren't outstanding in any way either. Mm. He's just like 1950s business attire, so think like a madman.
Mm, yeah.
Just a black tie, grey jackets, pants.
Probably a hat.
Yeah, probably a hat. Yeah. Probably a nice hat. They had good hats back then. That's one thing the guy wants to tie, good hats. Anyway. so he got taken in the customs and they questioned him and they said, "Oh, you're from Tower Head, this place doesn't exist." So... They continue on. He provides all these other documents of bills and his company's letterheads and stuff, all with addresses and stuff.
Wow.
From that list.
Did they take any photos or any?
Did they take the documents or the
passport? They took the documents. And we'll get to that part of it a little bit later. Now, they took the documents and they've said, "Oh, we're going to hold you for investigation.
Yeah.
We don't know what's going on here. We can't account for any of this." So they took him off to a hotel. It was on like the 18th floor or something. It was very high up. The only exit out of the room was a small window with no ledge. So it's like this sheer drop down to Concreteville.
Mm.
So anyway, there was 2 guards posted out the front of his hotel room and they left him there overnight. So customs officials come back in the morning and they open up the hotel room and he's vanished. There's absolutely nothing there.
No video footage.
There's nothing. Not
back then.
Not back then.
There's 1954. There's nothing. Yeah. So there's no sign of the man from Tauride. Now, the story goes is that all the documents they also took that were held by actually Tokyo police at that point in time, they also disappeared. So there is so this has just, in this instance...
And they didn't take any photos of it or anything? Or?
Well, it's 1954, you haven't got an iPhone yet. No, although we will get into
that.
Yeah,
but they had normal cameras back then. They
they
wouldn't have known to take it so quickly.
Like, you wouldn't have realised it. You would have just thought it was counterfeit.
Yeah.
So he completely disappeared. And that is the story. Now, and on the face of it, you can just say it's an anecdotal story that no face of it. And that's a lot of what the... a lot of what is being said around the story. That's not real. It's just a story. Yeah. It's been written. It's fictitious. Either way, I don't care. It's a pretty freaking good story.
Yeah. And even if it was an elaborate hoax or something, and
it was a hell of a hoax
of document forgery, and you know, trying to.
Yeah, but what if you go down that road of document forgery? Why would you forge a country that doesn't exist if you're trying to get somewhere?
Mm.
And they did call the business that he said he worked for, who was visiting in Tokyo.
Did they answer?
Yeah, they answered, but they said, when they called the number, you just go, we're not that business, we don't know this guy. So, in his reality, that business, if he's from Tauride, that business isn't the same business.
Yeah, it's a different business.
So, that part of the story would work out. Everything in the story rings true, and if someone's writing a fiction story, obviously they're going to tie it up nicely. It's good. But it's a damn good story.
So this is what quantum physicians talk about at dinner parties, like with universes colliding with other multiverses. And
when you're going into the multiverse theory and also quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics is like every single possibility that is possible exists
infinitely everywhere else.
So every time
there's multiple dimensions.
Yeah. So every time we make a decision, every time we step through the river of time,
every time we make a decision,
all of those probabilities of things we do, every one of them makes an alternate time. So like, an alternate me now might reach over and drink that bottle of scotchy.
I love scotch.
And I love scotch.
And just drink it.
Yeah, I love scotch.
I love my bubblehead. Bubblehead.
So in an alternative reality, I'll be sleeping on Jono's couch tonight and going to work.
You could, yeah.
Yeah, but so there's and every single possibility you could...
Infinitely.
Even like the smallest changes would create a different timeline.
So there could be a murmur where they just... accidentally cross over and wobble into each other.
There are stories where timelines come back together, they merge back together into like a more central timeline. So no matter what probabilities you are, they come back to certain key points in the timeline. Like there are key points in the timeline. And that's part of what I'll also discuss in a future podcast about my deja vu YouTube future travel quantum.
Because look, you know, I think everyone can say they've experienced some form of deja vu, so it's something that everyone can relate to.
Yeah, and there are other time slip stories which, in the Charlie Chaplin DVD of...
Oh, I've seen that video.
Yeah.
Where they had a man on the cell phone.
Yeah.
Or a lady.
Yeah, there's a lady on the cell phone.
That's right. I remember hearing about this at the premiere. Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, in the DVD of that.
But if you got to look closely enough to... You can't see a cell phone, but you can see her hand against her head.
Yeah.
Which is like she's holding a cell phone.
It could be an extraordinary coincidence of like she's about to... Pull a bit of wax out of her ear.
And there is analysis of it that says, oh, yeah, she's just got curly hair and she's rubbing her ear. But the thing is, like, if you're itching your head, you don't hold your hand still like that.
And she was walking around like that.
Oh, it's video.
Yeah.
Sorry, not video, but footage.
Yeah, it's video footage. So she's holding her...
like this.
And it's permanently still. Wow. So it's not like she's itching up and down or doing anything. It's just still. And you see this, like an iPhone 4 type shadow.
I remember hearing about that a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
Where did I hear that?
We should watch it on Jono's thing.
That'd be good.
And then also in 1938, there's another piece of footage of... there's a woman leaving, I think it's... it might be General Electric or And in her hand, she's walking out of the office and there's footage of it. And she's also got a thing in her hand. Now, there's stories in there that actually the company she worked for was working on a cordless phone. But this is back in 1938. Yeah. And the cordless phone was like the same size as your iPhone.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, you remember back when cordless phones first came out in like the 80s? Oh, bricks. They were bloody gigantic. Yeah, yeah. So there's no freaking way that that company in 1938 had a cordless phone that small.
Mm.
So there's another... That's another piece of footage.
I like it.
And then the greatest time travel story of them all in the modern era, even though it's probably been proven all to be bullshit, is the story of John Titor.
The guy who claims that he's from the future.
He's from 2037.
2037?
He went back to 1974 to get some wooden PC that he needed to save the world.
He needed to create the flux capacitor.
He needed to create the flux capacitor. There is more Reddit forums than this guy than you can even believe. But we're going to put a link to show notes about John Titor because he is effectively a show in himself.
So, that sounds great. Yeah.
But we will put notes up to...
That's a whole nother episode.
Oh, that is five episodes, John Titor. He is worth... Because there's different phases of when he leaves and comes back with all different types of crazy stories. And then he's always got the excuse of, oh, well, that happened in my timeline. So that's why it didn't happen in yours. Anything that doesn't happen can be explained away quite conveniently. So,
right. Has he said anything about World War III?
I think he did. I can't recall though, because I really got interested.
Does he make
in
any Nostradamus claims?
There's Nostradamus claims. We'll do this in the next.
All right, needs more explanation
because we
needs more digging.
This podcast has gone pretty long, and if we went on to John Titor, we'd be here for another 2 hours.
And we'd lose all our million listeners, 1 million listeners.
Yeah.
1 million bugs. In this... 1 million bugs outside listening to the airwaves coming from this room.
Yeah. I don't want to waste John Titor on five
minutes. We're going to build it. We start with Tim Tams and then we move to time travel a bit later.
Exactly.
All right, sounds good.
And I think... you won't be around for the next podcast. You'll be off.
Because he's getting hitched, I think.
He's getting married.
He's the old ball and chain. Yeah. So the next podcast will just be me and Jono. So we're going to look at a couple of DVDs, actually, a couple of documentaries. We're going to have a look at The Nightmare, which Jono hasn't seen or knows anything about.
Shadow People. I was talking about Shadow People.
Shadow People.
I can come back and hopefully shed some light on the current state of the Great Barrier Reef.
Yes. Yes, yes, we want to hear what it's like.
That's why I'm going, because it might not be there one day if the sea temperature keeps rising and whatnot.
Who knows if John Titor was right, it might be the last time you ever see it.
Well, okay, so that's a great segue. You're talking about Titor, I come back and go, you know what, Titor was right.
Yeah, so...
He was there.
He was there.
I met him.
Yeah. He put the starfish into the...
Yeah.
He battled the last starfish off the last barnacle, didn't he? That was him.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I bet they made a film about it too. Yeah,
they would.
This is the last barnacle in the Great Barrier Reef.
Yeah. Yeah.
Goodbye.
Yeah. Goodbye. And the other film that me and John Abel talk about is a documentary about the most famous UFO abduction of all time, of Travis Walton. So he's just released the first really good UFO documentary.
It's called Travis?
Called Travis. Yeah. That I've seen in a long time. I don't think anyone here in Australia would have seen it because it's been on limited release in the US.
Okay. And it hasn't been on Warwick Moss's... what was the show Warwick Moss used to do?
No. Warwick Moss.
Unexplained. What was his show?
I probably would have been. But
you're watching... What was it? I'm Warwick Moss. You're watching...
The Oz Files, whatever it was. No.
Warwick Moss!
Who's Warwick Moss?
Warwick Moss had his own, you know...
Is he Australian?
He's like the Russell Coit of the X-Files thing back in the 90s. But Warwick Moss had his own TV show and it was Ghost Stories.
Who was he played by?
Oh, yeah.
Gremlins Stories, Unexplained Phenomena.
Who was he played by? Was he Warwick Moss? Was that his real name?
Warwick Moss.
He had his own TV show.
No, I do remember
Unexplained Phenomena or something? Or Unexplained Stories?
Something.
Yeah, I'll have to look into that.
Yeah, but Travis and the Nightmare. The Nightmare, I don't. Both of which I think you can only buy in on DVD. You can get them on demand if you do some shifty VPN stuff, but
nothing that we do. Yeah, we don't.
No,
we don't.
No. Well, not in Australia. No.
Well, I do, but I don't know about you.
No. I've never downloaded a movie. We're
recording in Canada right now.
it's a beautiful day in Guatemala. Anyway, that's it for episode one of Rebel Scum Radio.
Cheers, Charles.
Cheers. Cheers, boys. Cheers.
To the future.
Cheers. To the future.
I guess, one other thing, we'll be talking about a little bit of more Star Wars news.
Yeah, definitely more Star Wars news.
Oh, let's not stay away from, talking about X-Men a bit. And
X-Men.
Let me talk a little bit of Marvel stuff, because we can't...
You're our Marvel man.
Yeah.
Otherwise, this show would turn into DC, and then imagine the haters. Imagine the Marvel.
Yeah.
Oh, don't get me wrong. I like Marvel, but the dark,
like
the dark
Marvel
stuff.
Too, but there's
some... The dark stuff.
And I'll have a small Ren and Stimpy side note. Because I want to talk about Ren and Stimpy.
Yeah, we need some Ren and Stimpy. We need some South Park.
We could spend a show on South Park.
Yeah.
Family Guy and Futurama. And
some Archer.
Ah, yes, Archer.
Archer. Yeah.
And Antique Roadshow and...
I've bought it by old some silver snuff box. Oh yes, that's as you can see here, it's got a stamp on it, and it's made in 1873, and by this fellow, this chap who had a small factory in Cornwall, and.
The cult of personality. I know your anger, I know your dreams. I've been everything you wanna be. Oh, I'm the cult of personality. Like Mussolini and Kennedy. I'm the cult of personality. The cult of personality. The cult of personality. Personality, the cult of personality.